What if we found a way to substantially reduce obesity? Around the world, 2 out of 3 people live in cities where obesity and overweight are killing more people than underweight. What if we could find a cure for mild depression and anxiety? What if we could save most of 1.2 million lives, 1.2 million lives that are lost every year in traffic, quote unquote, accidents, where more than 30 million injuries. It's about 100,000 people dead every month. What if children and youth could actually go places on their own? And walking and cycling, by the way, is not a frivolity. Walking and cycling is the only individual mode of mobility for all children and youth around the world. In rich countries, in poor countries, in northern, in southern, everywhere. And if they're going to go further, they can take public transit. What if our older adults could age in place with their friends? I know many older adults, some of them have cars, that they are terrified of the day that they lose their driver's license. Not because they love cars, because they love mobility. They want to go out of places. They want to continue living close to their friends and family. What if people all of a sudden, they could have money to pay for education and health and go on vacation and save money for retirement? According to the American Automobile Association, the cost of one car is almost $9,000 per year. So the two-car households in North America are spending around 20-25% of their income on mobility, 20-25% of the income. And in developing countries, it's between 35-45% because the cars cost them the same, but the income is less. There is nothing that the governments could do that have a higher impact on the quality of life of people that are allowing the possibility to downsize from 2 cars to 1 or 1 to 0 or never actually have it. What if we could have sustainable happiness for everyone? Happiness that is the well-being of the individual, the community, and global, but that does not exploit other people or the environment or the future. Actually, it's not a dream. It's not magic. It's sustainable mobility. It's walking. It's riding bicycles. It's using public transit. Walking. I underline king because from the point of view of vulnerability, in mobility, the most vulnerable is the pedestrian. That's how we were created. We were created as pedestrians. And when we walk, we are so happy because we use all our senses. We walk and we see the children playing, and we hear the birds singing, and we go in front of a coffee shop and we smell the aroma of the coffee. And we see the children walking in South Korea, and the youth, they walk to school in Johannesburg in South Africa, the older adults in Abu Dhabi, or the older people in Barcelona. We walk. People walk in the summer in Rio, people walk in the winter in Canada. And we also ride bicycles. I think cycling is just a more efficient way of walking. If we're going to go 1 kilometer, we walk. But if we're going to go 4 or 5, we take a bike. And cycling also don't make any noise. It's human power. And it's not just for the 20 to 50 men in spandex. It's for everybody. It's for the little kid learning how to balance, or the adults riding their bikes, or the older adult on their trike. It's for everyone. And public transit, if we're gonna go further away. And public transit is for all cities of all sizes. Cities of 10,000 people, 100,000, 1 million, or 10 million. They need public transit, different modes of public transit. But they all need public transit as a way to get to places. I'm not saying that this is the end of the car industry, but nevertheless, the use of cars is going to be very, very different in the future. Actually, in North America, the young people 18 to 24, in the last 2 years, purchased fewer cars than any time in the last 40, proportionally. Actually, they got fewer driver's licenses. The car is no longer a status symbol. It's more of a status symbol, an iPad, or traveling to Australia or to China. And now we have car sharing We don't have to have our own car. We need a few hours a week. We use car sharing and hydrogen and electric cars. And we gotta be creative and think outside the box. And the bicycles are gonna be used differently. And also we had roads in the old thinking, last century, when we had narrow roads where we couldn't fit cars and public transit, we said only cars. But in this century, the new thinking is if you don't fit cars and public transit, then only public transit. And people walking and cycling along the way. But we need to do this change fast. There is a sense of urgency that we need to develop all over the world, in every country. The population is growing. All over the world, the population is growing. The rate of growth has decreased, which is the good news, but nevertheless, less than 200 years ago, we had only 1 billion. Today, we have around 7 billion, and by 2050, we're gonna have 9.5 billion. So that means not only do we have to improve the cities that we have today, but we gotta create great cities for another 2.5 billion people. And from the point of view of population, there are two additional concepts. One is we're living longer, and two is we're moving into the cities. We're living longer. Just 200 years ago, there was no country in the world that had a life expectancy above 45. Today, there is no country in the world that has a life expectancy below 45. We learned how to survive, but now we need to learn how to live. Actually, the people that have ever lived up to 65, half of them are alive today. So we're living longer, but also we're moving into the cities, which is something exciting. In China, in the last 30 years, over 300 people have moved into the cities, and that has been a trend around the world. 100 years ago, only 2 out of 10 people lived in cities. Today, 5 out of 10 live in cities. In less than 100 years from now, 8 out of 10 are gonna live in cities. And 8 out of 10 of a much larger, today about 3.5 billion people live in cities. In less than 100 years, more than 7 billion people are gonna live in cities. So we need to create great cities for all people. And when we go to Rio and we see the people playing beach volleyball, we gotta follow the volleyball, because we gotta realize that we need to create cities for the haves as well for the have-nots that live in the favelas, along the hills. We need to create great cities for everyone around the world. It has to be inclusive. We gotta create great mobility for all. Another symptom is the cars. Only less than 10 years ago, there were only 600 million cars. That's why we need a sense of urgency. Today, we have over 1 billion cars, and by 2050, we're gonna have 3 billion cars. So we are gonna have 2 billion cars additional. So if you think that we got traffic congestion today, just imagine what the congestion is gonna be like with 2 billion additional cars. How much is 2 billion additional cars? Let's assume that each car needs 2 meters by 5 meters, 10 square meters. Just to park the cars, not to move the cars, just to park the cars, we would need to build roads that would go around the earth 249 times. We would be suffocating the earth in so many ways. Even if we have driverless cars or electric cars or hydrogen, there's not enough space or good use of the resources. So we need to change. And in some ways, there are good change, others not so good. I see in some cities where they say the emerging economies are doing well. Mexico, Brazil, Russia, India, China. And when the economies do well, you improve your health and education and entertainment. But one thing that you do not improve is mobility, when mobility is based on the private car. Actually, it gets much worse. When I go to India, I see huge traffic jams. In India, only between 15 and 20% of the people have cars, and there's huge traffic jams. The country is doing pretty well, so it's very likely that it could double the amount of people having cars. Can you imagine what it's gonna look like? At the same time, is that the best way to invest money doing elevated highways when huge parts of the population are really in extreme poverty? At the same time, we gotta think, we've been building cities for hundreds of years, for thousands of years, but it's been only in the last 80 that we have been building things more on cars. And there has not been one city that has been successful solving mobility through the private car. If that was an option, we would have hundreds of examples. So shouldn't these countries of emerging economies be creative and be looking for a new way, a new vision, a new mode of mobility? Instead of doing these elevated highways that are suffocating, shouldn't we start thinking of how these cities like Portland, that they are taking down the highways, or in Madrid, creating the Rio Park, Rio Madrid? Places like Seoul, South Korea, had this highway going right through the middle of the city. They tore it down, and they put public transit. And now they got a beautiful linear park right through the middle of the city. And the mayor, later on, was elected president. This was only 8 years ago that it happened. And in places like Argentina, in Buenos Aires, people say Buenos Aires is broke. No, doing things about walking, cycling, and public transit doesn't cost a lot of money. A lot of the downtown has become pedestrian in the last 3 years. In the last 3 years, they have turned more than 100 blocks of streets into pedestrian priority streets. In the last 3 years, they have built over 130 kilometers of protected bikeways. No one used to bike, 0.3%. Now it's at about 4%, and they want to go to 10%. When my brother Enrique was mayor of Bogota, two issues that he was obsessed in mobility was building bicycles. He built over 270 kilometers in 3 years of protected bikeways. In some places, the neighborhoods were so poor that it's hard for you to imagine the levels of poverty, but how they were transformed. And by the way, why do we need to have really good quality of walking and cycling? Because it's safer, and also because we need to dignify the pedestrian and the cyclist. And also, one thing that my brother told me when I started working around cities, he said, Gil, keep in mind that the civilized countries are not the ones where the poor have cars, but are the ones where the rich use public transit. And actually, he built a BRT system. This is what the transportation system used to look like. And in 36 months, they created a bus rapid transit that actually is a wonderful Latin American next from Curitiba, Brazil, and Bogota, Colombia, to the rest of the world. And they are doing this kind of public transit in many cities all over the world. Many BRTs, very successful in China. But it's not only BRTs. It can be subways, it can be trains, it can be LRTs, it can be, but it's public transit because it takes a lot less space. Walking, cycling, and transit. And of course, this is how we've been building the cities. This is very important. Why? Because we can have the best public transit in any city in the world, any city in China. But the public transit is not going to pick us up in front of our houses and drop us off in our place of destination. So we need to walk or bike to take public transit. So we need to create great places. And when we allow the cars to park on the sidewalks and encroach the little space that we leave for pedestrians, that is a symbol of inequality. That's an insult to people. That is a lack of respect for people. We are telling this woman every day, you are a second-class citizen. We know how to do it. These are not technical issues. These are not financial issues. This is, we need to decide. It's your decision. It's our decision. It's everybody's decision. But we need to move fast, as I mentioned. We have urgency. Today, we are having around 270,000 people killed while walking on the streets, on the sidewalks. People are walking, the cars are killing them. Imagine for a second, we got 4 planes flying, one over China, one over the US, one over Australia, one over Canada. They crashed, and everybody dies. And another 4 planes tomorrow, and another 4 planes the next, would be a huge world crisis. Well, that's how many people walking are killed every day. And over 5 million are injured. These are not accidents. They can be avoided. So what are we doing about it? Clearly not enough. So a lot of this is, how do we want to live? This is how we imagine that we like to live, and then we go out and build this. We are not consistent. This is at the same scale, Florence, Italy, and Atlanta. What if everything that we did in our cities, especially in mobility, the sidewalk, the street, the crosswalk, the bikeway, had to be great for an 8-year-old and also for an 80-year-old? If it's good for an 8 and good for an 80, it's going to be good for everybody, from 0 to 100. We need to stop building cities as if everybody was 30-year-old and athletic. And we got to build cities for everyone. We need to build cities for all. Even though now I work for an NGO based in Toronto, Canada, and I've been working in over 180 different cities. I want to tell you an anecdote. I want to end with an anecdote when I was commissioner in Bogota. I came and I found a small program called Ciclovía, where we opened the streets to the people and closed them to cars. Only a few kilometers, a few thousand people. But then I thought of something. When we look at any city from the air, the biggest public space are the streets. The public space, the space that belongs to all of us. Actually, the streets are about 20-25% of our cities. The streets are between 70-90% of the public space that belongs to all of us. So to use them just for moving cars 24/7 doesn't make a lot of sense. So that's why I was so excited about this idea. And from a few kilometers and a few thousand people, we went to over 120 kilometers in 4 years and to more than 1.3 million people every Sunday of the year. And this program now has been adapted to hundreds of cities around the world. So we need to create broad alliances, alliances between the private sector and the public and the NGOs, alliances between the elected officials and the public sector staff, but not just from transportation and planning, from public health and environment and economic development. We need to create alliances between everybody. Be very inclusive. Sustainable mobility is not just about walking or riding bicycles or using public transit. It's about creating successful cities and healthy communities where all citizens are going to live happier. That's why I want you to think of sustainable mobility as a path to create health, wealth, and happiness. Thank you.